Praise the Lord. God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
Amen. Make sure I'm all turned on here. Glory to God. Thank you. How many of you are enjoying the conference so far?
Amen.
Amen. Man, we've already had some testimonies coming in of relationships that are being restored, healed. Amen. Glory to God. And people seeing the glory. We prayed that the Lord would open people's eyes. And Dad, why don't you just share really, really quick what you had told me earlier.
Yeah, last night, when Greg was talking about the glory, I painted my glasses off and cleaning them because it seemed like they were kind of foggy and fuzzy. And normally when I've seen the glory across the park, and it's been many times over the years, normally it would rest up kind of high, but last night it was right down among the people, right down where everybody was sitting. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And so that's no small thing when the Lord lets you see that. Anybody else see this? Have you been in a new barn? All right, there's a great hand or two. Just because you haven't seen it doesn't mean it's not real. Because I sat under Brother Hagin for many, many years, and he would talk about the glory of God. And I'm looking and looking, and I didn't see it. But when I started my first church, I started pastoring, it began to show up. Every place I've ever been, it's always shown up. We hit it in the worship barn, the small worship barn, many times, but it's good to know that it's in here too.
Amen.
Amen. God is good. Just a couple of really quick announcements. We are videotaping these sessions for the conference, and we're going to make those available through our YouTube channel. The best way to find it is to go to our website, just gregbitely.com, and when we post, we'll put there'll be a link on the website to the YouTube channel. And it'll all be there for free. You can watch as many times as you want, download whatever you need to do. But with the exception of just a couple of the sessions, because of technical difficulties, we have been able to record everything. And so we'll make that available. And two, on the back table back there, there's a number of free materials we hope that you would take advantage of. A lot of it's just healing scriptures and things that'll feed your faith and be a blessing to you. Amen. Romans chapter 4, we're going to begin there this morning. Romans 4, that's a verse of scripture that the Lord dropped in my heart some weeks ago. I've been up here now for, it'll be 8 weeks altogether, and just traveling in the area and going over to Ontario and different places. And I got back late one night, and it was on a Tuesday night, and Brother Ian was ministering up at the worship barn, and I was tired. I just wanted nothing more than to go upstairs and get in bed and go to sleep. And so I pulled in the driveway over there, and I believed in my heart that the Lord said, "I want you to go over to the worship barn." And I said, "Really?" Now, not because I didn't want to hear Brother Ian. I was just tired. I was just ready to be done for the day and just having a really tight schedule. And I said, "Lord, do you really want me to go over there?" And I just felt like he said, "Yes, I want you to go over to the worship barn." And so I put my stuff aside and came over to the worship barn. And I just very quietly tried to sneak in the back, and I sat in the back couch there. And he referred to a scripture. I don't even know if he expounded on it. He doesn't remember either. But all I remember is him saying Romans chapter 4. And when he said that, I opened up my Bible to Romans chapter 4. And God began to speak to me out of this portion of scripture that we began. And even Pastor Brian, the Lord was speaking to him about Romans chapter 4. He brought that up in one of his messages. But there were some things here, and I've preached from Romans 4 hundreds of times over the years, maybe even 1,000 times over the years. But you know what? God's word is pregnant. It's continually giving birth to new facets of truth. Now, there's nothing new in the scripture, but there's some things that can be new to you, and things that are fresh and that God quickens to you. And that's what we did here. In verse 16, it says, therefore, it is a faith that it might be by grace, to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed. Now, I like that.
Whoa,
I like that because sure to all the seed. There's some people, when I was going to Bible school, there were some people, you'd look at them, and they looked like the picture-perfect evangelist. I mean, they had the, I don't know what kind of haircut they call it, but I mean, it was slick back, just jet. And I mean, they were dressed to the T, and snappy. And so, I mean, you look at them, and I mean, they just look like they're made for TV. All right, but you know, you look at the on the outside. Now, just hang on a second. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. They look perfect on the outside. Amen. I mean, just everything perfect. And you look at somebody like that, and you ooh, and you ah, but then you take somebody like me or somebody else. Well, maybe we didn't have all the great advantages. You know, I come from a little place called Curtis, Michigan. Has anybody ever heard of Curtis, Michigan? I mean, it's just in the middle of nowhere, just the sticks, as we called it back then. But yet, if it's by grace, anybody can get a hold of it. Not just the elite person, not just the TV personality, not just the radio preacher, not just somebody that's especially anointed of God. Anybody can get a hold of it if it's by grace, because what comes by grace is a free gift, not based on your performance. Amen. There's you know, you ask some people about their Christian life. Well, I'm trying. It's based on performance. Amen? Instead of living out of the fruit of the life and nature of God that's on the inside of you, we're trying to please God. We're trying to do for God. We're trying to do all these works. And it's and we're basing how we perceive ourselves based on our performance rather than the free gift. Amen? There is nothing that you can do or not do to make God love you more or less.
That's right.
Amen. Now we can be more or less in obedience to Him, but He's not going to love you any less. Amen. And so what comes by grace is a free gift. And if it's a gift, you don't have to wait for it. How long did you have to wait for God to save you? When you heard the gospel message, and you believed in your heart, and you confessed with your mouth, how long did you have to wait to get saved? Would anybody argue that salvation is a free gift or not?
Amen.
It's a free gift. Amen?
Amen?
Not based on your performance, right? How long did it take to get saved? The moment that you believed, you got it. Amen? How long did it take you to get the baptism of the Holy Spirit? I had to wait 9 years for God to fill me with the Holy Ghost. No, the moment that you believed and yielded yourself, you received.
Amen.
You might have been hanging around the altar for 9 years, but not because you were in faith. The moment you believed in your heart and yielded yourself, you received.
That's great.
And started speaking in tongues.
Amen.
Amen. Didn't have to wait for it at all. Did you know that healing is also a free gift?
Great.
Not based on your performance.
Amen.
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 Not based on your performance. See, a lot of times we're trying to earn or deserve. There was a wonderful man that I knew very, very well. And he would come to our church occasionally. His wife came to our church all the time. He would come occasionally. He was Catholic. He's the only person in my entire life that was a true deacon that I ever saw. And he didn't even come to our church. That's too bad. But, I mean, when he would come over and visit our church for special meetings or whatever, it was in him to serve. I mean, he'd be, didn't even go to our church, he'd be back in the kitchen helping out. He'd be, helping people around the tables. We're having fellowship and different things. He's constantly helping and serving people. That's a true deacon, is to serve. Not to run the board and boss the pastor. No, that's not a deacon. That's the devil. But and it's true. I thank God I've been delivered from deacons. Amen. I can come in and give them a good punch and take off. Praise the Lord. And so I went to his funeral. And the Catholic priest was up there. And this is what he said, basically, in so many words. He was such a good man that we couldn't even think that he would miss heaven because he was such a good man. Basically, his entrance into heaven was because he was such a good man. Amen. I'll guarantee you this. When you and I get to heaven, we're going to see people. How in the world did you ever get here? Amen. And there'll be people in hell. How in the world did you ever get here? Same way as everybody else. Amen. See, what comes as a free gift is not based on your performance. It's not based on you being good enough or bad enough. There are some people that they really don't live much of a Christian life, but they'll grab onto something when they see it in their heart. Amen? And that's really where healing is that it is provided through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It came as a free gift. And whosoever will take hold by faith of that healing, they can have it right now. Yeah. Amen? It doesn't matter if it's stage 4 cancer or chronic hangnail. You can take hold and latch hold of what belongs to you right now. You don't have to wait for it. Amen? Well, then why sometimes does it take so long to get healed? Well, sometimes you got to get rid of a lot of the doubt. Now, my wife Karen, she trains horses. And when we first met and she was showing me a lot of stuff about training horses, she said that when you're training somebody else's horse, oftentimes you have to get the trash out. They've picked up bad habits. They've picked up, maybe they bite or maybe they're disrespectful. And you've got to work on getting the trash out. And then you can put good stuff into them. Amen. And a lot of times when it comes to our faith and when it comes to Christianity, you got to get the trash out. Because sometimes people are taught a lot of stuff that's not scriptural and not the Word of God. And so you got to deal with doubt and unbelief. And sometimes that's a process. Yeah. Amen. I was telling Pastor Dad this. What if you could get a group of people and totally get all the doubt out? What would happen if you got all the doubt out, Pastor Steve, of the church?
Wow.
Man alive. Now come with me, if you would, to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 53. Are you getting anything so far today?
Yes.
Isaiah 53. You're familiar with this scripture. See, it's by grace. See, faith receives what grace has provided. Did you know that the same grace that's afforded to me is also afforded to you? Amen? There's no distinction. But faith is what brings what grace has provided into your possession. Amen? So you have to know what grace has provided in order for faith to take hold of it. If you don't know that it's been provided, you can't take it. Amen? And so notice here in Isaiah 53, and let's begin here with verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Now, I want you to notice something here. You have the word sorrows and you have the word griefs. In the actual Hebrew, it means sicknesses and pains. And actually, some of the modern translations will bear that out. The New King James Version, if you have a good New King James Version, the Study Bible Edition, there'll be a little footnote at the bottom of the page that will say sicknesses and pains. Because that's what the Hebrew brings out. And it says here, verse 4, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Again, that's sicknesses and pains. He bore them. Well, where did he bear them to? Where did he convey them away to? Well, that was at the cross. Jesus was not sick with your sickness. He was not diseased up with your diseases in that sense. But when he went to the cross and he hung on that place of punishment and shame, he atoned for our sicknesses and diseases. In other words, the punishment that was needful to have peace with God was placed on him. He bore it. He was not sick a day in his life. He was not poor a day in his life. Amen. But he took those things upon him and became sin. He became sickness. He became poverty when he hung on that cross. And it says here, he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Now we know that it was the Roman soldiers that scourged him and whipped him and beat him. The Romans used a whip that was called the cat of nine tails. It had a handle, and then it had nine strands of leather that proceeded out from the handle, and on the end of each strand of leather, there was a piece of metal or some sharp object that was there, and when they would whip the person, it wasn't just like taking a lashing, they would literally whip that cat of nine tails, it would embed into the flesh, and then they would rip it out. Now, I'm not trying to upset anybody this early in the morning, but we need to understand the punishment that was needful to obtain peace with God was laid on him. There are people that say, well, Jesus, he didn't go to hell. Well, if he didn't, then you're going to have to. If he didn't take the punishment for your sin and my sin, then you're going to have to. Amen. He did take the punishment. He did suffer in the regions of the damned. Our sin was laid upon him. Our sicknesses were laid upon him. Amen. And the Bible says here that it was God that did that. The Roman soldiers, they outwardly did to his body what God did to his spirit. Only God could put our sicknesses on him. Only God could put our sins on him. Only God could put our poverty on him. Only God could do that. Amen? The Roman soldiers couldn't do that. What the Roman soldiers did was an outward sign of an inward work. It was God that laid on him the sin of the whole world for all time. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Healing belongs to you as much as salvation does.
Amen.
Would you say that salvation is available to the worst sinner?
Yes.
Yes.
Then you'd have to say healing is available to the worst sinner. Man, I don't know about you, that just jumped inside of me. Amen. Because it's not based on your performance. Amen. Now, the scripture says, Jesus told one person, go and sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. See, what happens a lot of times is sin opens up the door to things. But healing is not based on your performance. I was shaking hands with people one time, and the word of the Lord came to me saying, because there's a girl that, I mean, she was constantly sick. Always going to the doctor. I mean, just regular, weekly going to the doctor. And I mean, she's got serious stuff wrong, but they can't figure out what it is. What's causing all this? So I'm shaking hands with people. I shook her hand, and she's walking by from the sanctuary over in the fellowship hall. And the Spirit of God spoke to me and said she has a spirit of infirmity because of the places that she's been and the people that she's been around. Well, that wasn't really a setting to cast the devil out of her. Now, she wasn't possessed, but it was just like, you know, you might have ants in your house. Well, you don't throw away the house, and it doesn't mean you've got ants in you because you live in the house. But you deal with the ants. See, your body is the house that you live in. And Satan can come to try to oppress and oppress your body. He can come against you, and sometimes you've got to deal with that spirit to get free in your body. Well, it was just not the place or the time of the setting. I didn't have a chance to minister to her. So a few Sundays later, she ends up at the front of the church. I thought, well, this is my perfect opportunity. And so I ministered to her, and I cast that spirit out. Now, she didn't scream and foam at the mouth and slither like a snake on the floor. I just ministered to her, cast the devil out of her, and that was the end of it. She didn't have to go to the doctor anymore. Amen. Those chronic problems ceased when you dealt with the spirit. But see, she had opened the door because there was a time in her life where she was hanging around the wrong people and partying and not living the way that she was supposed to. She was a Christian and spirit-filled, but she wasn't living up to her potential. Amen. And so she had opened the door to some things. I tell you what, you got to keep the door closed. Amen. There's been times where I have missed it and opened the door for sicknesses to try to come and latch onto my body. So what do? You get that door shut as fast as you can. But the healing is not based on your performance. It was based on what Jesus did. Amen. Amen. Now, come with me, if you would. With His stripes, we're healed. Matthew chapter 8. Now, I want to tell you the very best way to be healed right now is just knowing what we're saying here this morning. You really don't have to have hands laid on you ever.
That's right.
Now, see, now I say that, and here God's given me a ministry of laying on of hands with a tangible anointing. But you really don't need that. Now, you can be healed just knowing what the Bible says. The Scripture says you know the truth, and the truth will make you free.
Amen.
Amen. But see, God is so good that He put so many different methods and means of healing in the Scriptures, you're bound to be able to relate to one of them. Amen. I mean, you can take a cloth with the healing anointing, put it on somebody's body, and they can be set free and delivered. You can anoint somebody with oil and they can be delivered and healed. You can spit on somebody and they can be healed. Jesus did it. He spit on the ground, made clay of the spittle and stuck it in somebody's eye. You can be healed that way. Jumping into the pool, you can be seven times be healed that way. I mean, He put all kinds of methods and means to be healed. Laying on of hands. Getting the elders to pray for you. Lots of different ways. You're bound to be able to relate and to latch onto one of those. Amen. But the best way is to simply know what the Word says and act on it for yourself. Amen. So notice here in Matthew chapter 8 and verse 16, when the evening was come, they brought unto Him many that were possessed with devils, and He cast the spirit out with His word. Now, this is just a little side note here. you don't see the devils being cast out through the laying on of hands. But you speak the word to them.
Yes,
amen. They have to obey the word.
Exactly.
And the word that you speak. Amen. And it says here, and healed all that were sick. Any time where you see where it says he healed them all. Now he didn't do that everywhere, but there were times in certain crowds, in certain audiences, he healed everybody that was there. And they were not unlike you and I today. There were people that if you were there and you knew them, you'd say, well, they don't deserve it. But he healed them all. Amen. And then there were times where you'd have thought, man, they absolutely deserve it. And not one of them got healed. Because it's not based on performance. It's based on what Jesus did. And anybody that will receive that by faith can have that power manifest in their body and they can be healed. Notice it says, verse 17, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. So we just read what Isaiah said, saying himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Amen. He took them. Now let me just say this. If he took them, what are you and I doing with them? What he bore, you need not bear. If he bore it, if he took it, you don't have to take it. Amen? That belongs to you. See, the Bible said it's by faith through grace that the promise is sure to all the seed. This is the promise. This is the truth. This is the facts of God's word that we're reading here. This is not just my teaching. It's not just some church doctrine. This is Bible. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, himself took, himself bore. Himself means himself and no other. He bore it. He took it. And if he did, then I don't have to have it. By meditating on these truths and allowing that to soak into your inner consciousness, into your spirit, just that truth will drive out sickness and disease.
Amen.
And physical deficiency. Himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Sickness and disease has become a very natural part of the human life. And it was never meant to be that way. It's a curse. It does not come from God. Well, yeah, but God allows it. Well, let me just ask you this. How many of you either have kids or have had kids? Maybe you've got grandkids. Well, most everybody. And you've been cooking in the kitchen, and you've got one of those glass top stoves like we have at home. And when you turn it off, it looks like it's off. But then you know that that glass countertop's hot. And you tell, you know, little Johnny, little Susie, whoever, you know, your grandkids, now don't go in, don't touch that. It's hot. And so you're working there in the kitchen, you're doing different things, and little Johnny, little Susie goes up there and touches that hot burner, and they scream. Well, whose fault is it? See, we would say it's God's fault. He allowed it. Well, he said what would happen. He made provision for our safety. But if we violate what God has said and come out from underneath that umbrella of provision, man, we're going to get in trouble.
That's right.
Amen? And that's how sickness and disease operates. God has put the means and method in his word to be free from sickness and disease. But if we violate the principles, then we forfeit our rights and privileges. Plain and simple. Amen? He's told us here how to not only get healed, but to stay healed and to stay healthy and to stay strong.
That's it.
Amen? Himself. These are not just obscure passages. These are foundational scriptures in the Word of God. Now go with me to 1 Peter 2:24. 1 Peter 2:24. You're familiar with it. We'll look at it. We'll let our eyes rest on it. 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. Now let me ask you this. Is it the blood of Jesus that causes the remission of sins and brings to us the remission of sins? Well, yes, it is. For without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. It's the blood of Jesus that washes us and cleanses us from all sin, right? Is there anybody that would disagree with that? Amen. We'll pray for you to get saved after the service. Where'd that blood that cleanses us from all sin come from? The stripes that purchased our healing. It's all one package. There are some people, some whole denominations, that say that, healing was kind of a side issue with Jesus. No, it's a main issue with Jesus. Because those stripes that he took on his back, where the blood flowed, brought to us the remission of sins so that we could be accepted to God. But the stripe itself healed you. When those lashes were embedded into his back and the flesh was ripped out, the blood flowed. But that deep furrow that was made in his flesh healed you. That's why we say you are healed now. He's not going to take another whipping for your bad diagnosis. He already healed you. 2,000 years ago, when he was strapped to that whipping post and those Roman soldiers whipped him with that cat of nine tails, sin was being dealt with. Sickness and disease was being dealt with. And those lashes that he took 2,000 years ago, they healed you. Amen. 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 You're not going to be healed. Well, how come God to heal this person over here and he won't heal me? Well, God didn't do something special for them that he didn't do for you. It's by grace. He already did it. Jesus himself already took everything upon himself to take care of your healing. All you have to do is receive it. That's all you got to do. Think about that. Now, let that soak in. Let that sink in. That might be a load for somebody. Amen. Because a lot of times we've dealt with things and suffered with things for year after year after year. But it's time to be free. You don't need anybody. Now thank God for laying on of hands. But you don't need that. You can believe this word. Let me show you another scripture here real quick. Psalm 107. We'll close with this. I'm not even sure how we're doing for time. Psalm 107. You're going to flip out over this. Psalm 107, verse 20. Can somebody tell me what that says? I still hear pages turning.
Fools, because their iniquities are afflicted.
No. Psalm, did I tell you the wrong verse? Psalm 107, verse 20. He what?
Sent his word.
He sent his what?
Word.
He sent his what?
Word.
He sent his word and did what?
Healed
them. And delivered them. Well, what word did he send? Himself took our infirmities. And bore our sicknesses. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet. Amen. He sent his word and healed them, by whose stripes ye were healed. If you were healed, then you are healed. Amen. Oh, but Brother Greg, I'm just so weak. I'm just so sick. Let me just tell you the truth. You're lying about it. I'm so sick, I'm so weak, I'm so tired, I'm so miserable, I'm so ugly. Well, that might be true, but if God says by whose stripes you were healed, and you're saying you're not, somebody's lying. Is God lying about it? Now, it might be a fact that you have sickness and disease coming against your body, but that fact is not the truth. The truth is, you were healed. And if you will hold fast your confession of faith of the truth of God's word, it'll change your fact. It'll cause your body to line up with the truth. Amen. If you hold faster. Because see, God's word is stronger than what you can see with your eyes. More powerful than your feelings. More powerful than your emotions. More powerful than a bad report. The Bible says if you believe the report of men, the report of God is greater. Amen. Amen. See, there's sometimes people, especially as a pastor, they want you to pray that I'll get a good report. It doesn't matter what the report is.
That's right.
Whose report are you going to believe? It's not just a song. We will believe the report of the Lord, but you got to find out what the Word says. See, here's the problem, is that we're very weak oftentimes in the Word. We're very strong on emotion and feelings, but very weak where the Word is concerned.
Amen.
We need to turn that situation upside down and be strong in the Word and not so much in our feelings and our emotions. We're the least little bad report, and I mean we're just all in tears and hysterical. And then we go Google our diagnosis and get all the information that we can. And so, and the weeks go by, and we haven't even cracked the Bible open. We haven't even prayed about it. We've been, you know, just educating ourselves because we got a bad report. Amen. No wonder people die, and then folks say, well, that healing stuff, that must not be true because they were such a good Christian. Amen. Man, I could say something, but it'd be too strong. It would hurt people and not help them. Amen. God's word is true. Your lack of experience or my lack of experience is not the basis for what we believe in the Bible. The Bible stands true whether we have a good experience or not.
Exactly.
Amen. I said that as politely as I could.
Good job.
Amen. But notice here, he sent his word and healed them. How do you receive the word? You get up in the morning, you brush your teeth, you comb your hair, and you come down to the conference. When your body feels like sleeping in, you get your Bible, you get your notebook, and you're coming down to the conference because you're hearing the word of God. Amen. And you receive the word with these things called ears. Remember that first message that I did? They came to hear him and to be healed. The word is the healer today. Let me close with this. The Bible says that Jesus is the living word. Amen. He's the living word. And I've heard people say this, that, oh, if I could have only just gotten to Jesus, I know that I would have been healed. And I always tell them, I doubt it. I do that a lot of times to shock people. There were multitudes of people that Jesus did not heal. Amen. There was one place, there was 5,000 people on the porch. He ministered to one man. What about the other 4,999? He left them. Amen. There's a lot of people in Jesus' day, they did not receive. The Bible talks about how that when people touched the hem of Jesus' garment, virtue went out. There was a multitude there, and the Bible says, as many as touched were made perfectly whole. It gives you the indication there were people, well, I don't believe that. And so they didn't touch, and they walked away, and they were not made whole.
That's right.
But everyone that did touch was made whole.
Amen.
Jesus operated in his healing ministry the way that you and I have to. He told those blind men, do you believe that I'm able to do this? What kind of question is that? I mean, if he's ministering in a synagogue with all the power, he can just do whatever he wants to. But that's not true. He had to have faith just like is required today. He sent his word to heal them. Here's the point I want to make is the same power that was resident in the living word when he walked on this earth is available in this written word. Himself took. Do you believe it? Do you receive it? Then the same power that Jesus, if Jesus were here in the flesh, And we could see him, and we could hear him with these ears, and we could go up and touch him, that same anointing that is in him is in that book right there.
Amen.
No different.
Sure.
No different. I've heard people say, oh, if I could ever just get to Benny Hinn, I know that I'd be healed. Well, they died waiting to get to Benny Hinn.
Yeah.
Waiting for him to come out to Vancouver and died in the process. I told him, I said, you don't have to wait. But somehow or another, I failed. I couldn't get him to see that he could receive right now. He was so fixated on Benny Hinn. Now, nothing wrong with Benny Hinn. I'm not criticizing him. He's a minister and anointed of God.
Okay.
Amen. But this word will heal you now. You don't have to wait for some special minister to come. You don't have to wait for some special service. You can receive whatever this Bible promises you right now.
Amen.
Not down the road, not a week from now, not 10 years from now, right now.
Amen.
Because it's based on grace.
Amen.
It's based on faith. You receive what grace has provided by faith. Amen? And you take it now. Well, how do you do it? Very simple. The Bible says, concerning the weak, let the weak say, I'm strong. Let the poor say, I'm rich. Let the sick say, I'm healed. See, that's what Abraham had to do. Call those things that be not as though they were. He began to call himself the father of many nations when there was no nations in sight. There were no children in sight. He began to say, I'm the father of many nations. I'm the father of many nations. I'm the father of many nations. I'm the father. Take out the trash, father of many nations, his wife would say.
Yeah.
Mow the grass, father of many nations, his wife would say.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. And so he said that. And what he said and confessed became a reality in his life. If you'll confess what the Word of God says you are, it'll become a reality. I'm healed.
Amen.
I'm strong. I'm blessed.
Jesus.
Amen. By confessing those things, you're establishing the reality of that in your life, and it won't be very long until you see it. Amen. Did you get anything?
Yeah.
I don't even know where we are for time. I apologize if I went over. Praise the Lord. But I tell you what, the Word of God's good, isn't it?
Amen.